Well, good morning. Welcome to Memorial. We're glad you're here this morning in person. It's great that you could be here to worship. We're also glad you're joining us online, have an opportunity to connect not just with the family here, but as a community at large, and just share God's word and just be in his word. And that's what we're doing this Sunday. We're just in God's word, and Pastor Aaron will be unpacking this morning the uncertainty of life. And what does that mean? And why is life so uncertain? And the one thing we have that's certain is uncertainty. And that's what we're going to be looking at today. And on that same line of uncertainty, I have a couple announcements as we plan forward to come back to full services. We're looking at bringing the 9:30 service, the middle service, back starting September 13th. And what that will look like, we don't know yet. The elders will be meeting this week to discuss and to determine what will be put in place for that service and what it'll look like and how we will go forward. But it's what we can do. It's all we can do in these uncertain times is plan ahead and prepare for change. So we're looking forward to what it means to come back with all three full services and get back into doing the work God has called us to do. And with that, I want to mention again the Red Letter Challenge, which is the discipleship challenge we have coming up this fall, kicking off on that Sunday. It is a discipleship challenge, a 40-day challenge through the Gospels and through the words of Christ. And we are gearing up for that now. We're in the process of bringing together small group leaders. If you are interested in leading a group, if God has put on your heart and you don't know what to do, contact one of us here at the church. Next Sunday, we will have an open class after church. It'll be at 1:30 here, and we will discuss what does it mean to lead a small group, how does it work, and also give the resources for that. We will have small groups that will meet each week through this process, as long as your daily devotional work that you will be doing through it as well. We look forward to that and to what God has planned and in store for us in the future. With that, why don't we take a moment and stand, and we'll welcome each other here this morning. We're still doing the waves. You can wave. If you elbow bump, I won't tell anybody, I promise. Waving to people online. They wave back, it's just weird. And we begin this morning by calling on God's name, and we do that in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Cross before me, the world behind, no turning back, raise the banner high, it's not for us, it's all for you. Let the heavens shake and split the sky, let the people clap their hands and cry, it's not for us, it's all for you. Not to us, to your name be the glory, and not to us, but to your name be the glory. Our hearts unfold before your throne, the only place for those who know, it's not for us, it's all for you. Send your holy fire on this offering. Let our worship burn for the world to see. It's not for us, it's all for you. to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. The earth is shaking, the mountains shouting, it's all for you. The waves are crashing, the sun is raging, it's all for you. The universe spinning and singing, it's all for you. Your children dancing, 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 it's all for you. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us.
I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold.
With you, and my song sings out as your word flows out far away. I sing to you, and my heart cries only hallelujah. Father, you're near. My hope is in you, Lord. Passes understanding is my song, and I sing, my hope is in you alone. I wait with you, and my soul finds rest in my selfishness. You show me grace. I worship you, and my heart cries glory. In you, Lord, all the day long. be shaken by drought or storm. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm. He surpasses understanding is my song, and I sing. My hope is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord.
Now we take a moment to affirm our faith. Our faith in our God, our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Restorer. And we affirm this faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may have a seat now as we hear God's word from Scripture.
The Old Testament reading today comes from Job 38, verses 4 through 18. Only the Lord, our Creator God, not man, holds the power and authority over all things. Starting at verse 4. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me, if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set, or who laid its cornerstone, while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb, when I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, this far you may come and no farther, here is where your proud waves halt. Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light and their upraised arm is broken. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the shadow of death? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The gospel comes from Matthew 14, verses 22 to 33. The disciples begin to realize that there is much more to Jesus than what was easily seen. Starting at verse 22, immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and, beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated.
I'd like to call the kids forward for kids time, but on your way up, there are some blue lines. You need to walk on the blue line. Can you walk on the line? And then find a green dot to sit on. Oh, good job. Good job. All right. So, Elsie's very... Zach, can you walk on the line? Walk on the line. Oh, perfect. All right. Have a seat right there on that green dot. All right. So, you walked the line. You walked on that blue line. Now, should we go out back to the pool and see if you can walk on water?
Yeah.
Yeah? Should we do it? Do any of you think you could walk on water? You still want to get in the pool? We don't have a pool. You know what the neighbors do, though? Up on the hill, they have a pool. We could probably go knock on the door and say, "Hey, we're here. We need to test this out. Can Harper walk on water? Harper, can you walk on top of the water?" You'd sink. You are so smart. Lydia, could you walk on top of the water? No, why? You would sink, yeah. So if you were listening, Shirley just read the gospel lesson about Jesus walking on the water. The disciples, he sent the disciples in a boat, and they went out on the boat. And while they were out on the boat, the waves and the winds started shaking, so the boat started shaking. Can you make your boat shake? Yep, so the boat was shaking, and then they looked out, and here is someone walking towards them, and they thought it was a ghost, but it was Jesus, and Jesus was walking on the water. Now, I don't know about you, but I would probably freak out. I'd be like, "What are you doing?" And so then Peter says, "Lord, what are you doing?" And Jesus said, "Take courage, it's I. Don't be afraid." And Peter said, "Lord, if it's you, tell me to come out on the water." So Jesus said, "Come on." So Peter got out of the boat, and he started walking towards the Lord on the water. He did not sink until he took his eyes off of Jesus. Then he started thinking about the waves and the wind, and then he started to sink. And what did Jesus do? Reached out and grabbed. Yeah, he didn't let him drown. Didn't let him sink. He reached out and grabbed him and said, "Hold on." And he said, when he saw the wind and he was afraid, he began to sink and cried out, "Lord, save me." But immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" The disciples then got another glimpse of who this Jesus was, the Son of God, who could walk on water. I can't walk on water. You can't walk on water. But Jesus did, to show us how great and mighty he is, and for us to have faith and trust in him, to know that no matter what, when we're scared in the boat and we're being rocked around, he will come to us because he loves us. So let's fold our hands and say a prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us all that we need, especially Jesus, who died to save us because he loves us. Help us be strong and not be fearful, but keep our eyes on Jesus. Amen. All right, you may return to your seat and see if you can walk on the lines.
Could you socially distance your feet a little bit, Doug, please? I'm going to go back here. Thank you. But now what do I do? Kind of stuck in one place, aren't I? Have you ever felt yourself like in over your head? Peter almost literally was in over his head as he walked out on the water, as Jesus gave him that ability to walk on the ground. And in fact, I'm going to step in over my head now and move to this spot right here. He was in over his head, wasn't he? Have you ever found yourself in over your head? Maybe at work? Maybe a project you took on? Maybe there's something out in the garage that's been taking place for the last 5 years, and you're in over your head. Mm-hmm. You ever in over your head and wonder, what am I going to do about it? What do you do when you're in over your head? Guess we could just give up, right, and say, no use, it's over. Sometimes we get frustrated with each other when we're in over our heads. How come this turned out this way? It's got to be your fault. You know, if you only would have, gets to be that way sometimes. We could get angry. We get angry at God when we're in over our heads. We can reach into ourselves as deep as we can dig and find that extra energy, the extra zeal, and say, I've got this one, and nobody else bother me now because I'm in charge. I'm making it happen. We can do that. And incidentally, I don't think there's anything wrong with reaching into our resources and using what God has given us, the abilities He's placed in our lives, the initiatives He's given us, the thoughts He's given us, the drive He's given us to try to take on problems that we live on in life. The danger comes, though, when we begin to find ourselves where we see Job. Not that we use resources God's given us, but that we leave Him out of the picture and forget who is our Creator in the first place and abandon what He might have for us, His word, His ways. And here's Job in over his head. And you almost kind of need to know the background to the story of Job. And I can do it very briefly. Job was besought by many ills of this world. A lot of things came against him. He wound up with weather that destroyed his crops. His animals that he was farming died. His health became very poor. He lost his family, most of his family, to accident, to things that happened in their lives that are no longer there. He didn't have children anymore. He was in over his head, didn't know what to do about it, didn't say much about it, had some friends that came and gave him some advice, kind of said, you know, Job, there's got to be something you did that's pretty wrong here. If you just dig a little bit deeper inside yourself now and figure out what you did wrong, you can kind of get rid of it and things will be better again. God can let you live one more time, perhaps. And they gave him all kinds of different advice. It would be pretty much, look to yourself, Job, figure this thing out. He also got advice from his wife. Remember the advice he got from his dear, loving wife? Hey, Job, why don't you curse God and die? If you could just curse God, just kind of let it out, curse God because you got no use for him anyway. It's over, Job. Just go ahead and do that and die and get out of your miserable self. And finally, Job did indeed complain against God and said, Dear God, why did this even happen to me? This stuff shouldn't have happened to me. I shouldn't have lost everything I lost. I've done everything you've asked me to. I've been a good man. Why? Where are you? Couldn't you have done differently here? Really? And it's at that point that we get to our reading out of Job chapter 38. And this is just a portion of it. If you look at Job 38 through 42, it's much the same. This gives you a taste of what God says to Job. As Job asks the question, God, how come you aren't standing where you should? How come you're not doing the things you should be doing as God? Aren't you in charge here? Or what have you done? I guess I'm going to have to take over. And the Lord says, Job, where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Who marked off its dimensions? Oh, surely you know, don't you, Job? Little sarcasm coming here from God to Job as Job says, you should be a better God, God. The Lord says, who do you think you are, Job? Think about this a little bit. And he goes on and he talks about all the things that he has done, everything he's put into place, his power over things. Job, you should be questioning me? About halfway through God's dialogue to Job, his speaking to Job, about halfway through, Job says, just a minute, God, you can stop now because I'm getting the picture. I shouldn't have said anything. In fact, I opened my mouth up twice and I made mistakes. I'll be quiet from here on. And God says, yeah, Job, you will, but let me tell you more. And God keeps talking and keeps talking. And if you go through those chapters, 38 to 42, it's very beautiful poetry, the way it's been structured, but it's quite a description of God who knows all things and of the vastness of creation and of God's relationship to all things and saying, Job, are you really in charge? Do you think you're in charge? Job, I am God and there is no other. And finally, at the very end of this whole discussion, if you will, Job finally says, God, I repent. I turn from my way of thinking, and I trust you. Job was in over his head, and he decided to take the route of, God shouldn't be in charge. I'm going to put myself in charge. But finally brought low to realize he needs God. How about those disciples in the boat? They were in over their heads too. They got out in the water and maybe didn't read the weather signs right, but they were in the storm in the middle of the lake, and Jesus wasn't with them. He had been in the mountainside praying. And you can imagine what it was like on the boat. Can you just kind of picture it? They're in the boat, and I'm going to imagine the boat had a sail on it, and one's saying, hey, put the sail up because it's going to keep us steady in this thing. Oh, no, the sail's going to drag us down. You can't have that sail doing anything. Well, release the tension over here. You, move to this side of the boat. How about you? Make sure you move to the back side of the boat. Oh, we're going to drown. Everybody put their head between their legs and pray. Not really knowing what they're doing so well. They're in over their heads. They're terrified. If you go to other gospel accounts of the disciples on the water, not necessarily this time, they were in the water several times, and one other time they said, we're going to drown. Don't you care, Lord, if we drown? When he was in the boat with them sleeping. They're panicking. They're perishing. They're going to go down. And this time they see Jesus coming across the water, but they don't know it's Jesus. They think it's a ghost. And so when they see Jesus walking on the water, they're terrified and saying, it's a ghost. Who is that? And Jesus speaks out and says, it is I. The disciples, when they were in over their heads, panicked, were afraid, it seems like they were just about paralyzed. What do you do when you're in over your head? Are we in over our heads here in the year 2020? This year started with a bang, didn't it? My goodness, it wasn't too long until we were kind of watching a virus develop far away in another land. And all of a sudden, it was amongst us. Didn't know what to do. Probably still don't know what to do for sure. Are we in over our heads? Well, All kinds of different solutions. Do this over here. Don't do that over there. Make sure you do this. Make sure you don't do that. All kinds of things we throw at one another. What are we doing in the midst of in over our heads? Well, we can kind of fight each other pretty well. We'd be angry with each other quite a bit. I'm guessing a lot of the anger and the fighting, the sense of we don't belong together has a lot to do with this feeling like we're in over our heads. We don't know what to do. So sometimes we take charge, sometimes we give up. Sometimes we panic, sometimes we despair. What do we do when we're in over our heads? We're likely often to take the road that says, God, you don't belong in this picture anymore. I'm throwing you out. I'm going to go my own way. And we do that when we stop listening to what he has to say. We stop listening to his word. And not that we shouldn't use resources at our disposal the best we can, the science we have, the knowledge that we've gained, and work on this kind of a problem with one another. But we forget that God is still in the picture. We forget to listen to him. We forget to trust his ways, follow his ways, and we claw at one another, scream at each other. Do we feel like we're in over our heads sometimes? We can take that route of saying, we're in charge, we'll make it happen, God. You know, we've done that oftentimes as well, and yet when we're in charge, how quickly we look like we're not. There's a musical that I always loved watching, especially when it was made a movie, the musical Oklahoma. A lot of you know the musical Oklahoma. Some of you don't know the musical Oklahoma, but that musical was all about, and the play was all about, groups of people in the United States that were trying to work their way through a difficult time. And the country was growing. The country was expanding. Oklahoma was a frontier. It's set in the 1930s, just around the Dust Bowl time, just after the Great Depression. And farmers are wanting to tame the land, and cattle owners are wanting free range to be able to drive their cattle up and down the Great Plains. And there's fighting amongst farmers, and there's fighting amongst ranchers, there's fighting amongst cattlemen. Remember one of the songs in the musical is, "Oh, the farmer and the cowman should be friends." It's like, we need to be able to talk together. We need to be able to work this out. They could often feel like they were in over their heads. They fought each other. And then enter the city slicker, Will Parker from Kansas City, remember? Everything's up to date in Kansas City. We know what we're doing in Kansas City. We got this by the hands. We're people. We're strong. We can do whatever we want to do. Everything's up to date in Kansas City. He sings, they went about as far as they can go. Then he sings about how we built skyscrapers even 7 stories high. It's about as tall as a building ought to go. 20 gas buggies just moving by themselves. They went about as far as they can go. And we human beings, we're so strong, we're so smart, so intelligent. Is Kansas City as far as we went? And tell you what, in another 70 years, you're going to look back to the great metropolises and the Sioux Falls's of our age and say, oh, they used to think they went about as far as they can go. And see how far human wisdom can take us. And then it will be limited human wisdom and will always be limited human wisdom. And yet we'll put it up in front of God and say, God, we don't need you anymore. Stay out of our picture. Don't tell me about life. Don't tell me about living. I want to live the way I want to live. And God will have to bring out his Job monologue again and speak to us yet one more time. Dear friends, I just share these thoughts with you. They're brought to us in the scriptures for today to remind us that God is still God. We are not. but to remind us that as we receive the blessings of God, and as we live our lives with one another, as we work our way through difficulties and troubles and problems, you know, we could just all give up when it becomes really tough and say, it's all over, it's no good. Or we can say, we've got a God who holds us. And I don't know how, but he's going to do it. We need to learn to say with Job, the one thing I realize is that I don't realize everything. The one thing that makes sense to me is that I can't make sense out of all things. But I do know the one who does. I can trust the one who does. Look at Peter in the boat. Peter says, it's you, Lord? Jesus says, yes. Then let me walk to you in the water. I've got this one. I've got it figured out. And Peter steps out of the boat and he starts walking on the water. In the power of Almighty God, Peter's walking on the water. But look at Peter. Now, all of a sudden, Peter is in uncharted territory. We were talking about this in Bible study and thinking, boy, what would that be like actually walking on the water? Don't think about that too often. And the waves are going up and down. And if you're actually walking on water, how do you go up and down the wave, walk it up? I've not been there, okay? Uncharted territory. I'm in places that I'm not used to being. I'm in over my head. And finally, Peter sees that all, and it all crashes down on him, and he goes and sinks into the water, losing faith in anything that God would say or Jesus said. But Jesus reaches to Peter and saves and rescues. Even Peter, who had a hard time trusting what God could do, Jesus reached to rescue and bring back to him. And you and me, we're in over our heads. We can throw the blame everywhere else. We can even say, God, I don't need you. And yet God has still reached to you and still reaches to you in our Savior Jesus and says, I've got you. I've got this, and he reaches to us again and again. He reaches to us in the Lord's Supper as he says, receive me into you. Trust my word. Yes, the only thing certain is that we're not certain, but we know the one who is certain. And he speaks his words of promise and hope and life to us, and has never stopped doing that over the history of mankind, either when mankind had gone about as far as we could go. He rescues, he heals, he forgives. We live with confidence, always, forever, that we can trust. In the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Savior, our God, our rescuer, amen.
So the certainty of the uncertainness is that we need him. We need God, and we are drawn to him, and he asks us to come to him and repent and seek forgiveness, and he will restore us. And so now we come to him in that moment. So will you stand with me as we confess our sins before God? We pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we confess to you that our understanding of you is so limited. We are boxed in by our own ideas of what you should be and what you should do. We fail to trust your ways and turn to our own. We've made choices that don't honor you. We've made choices that don't serve our neighbor. Forgive our sins, dear Savior, and save us. As you have promised, show us your compassion and your power to save. We pray in your name. Amen. I have good news for you today. that you can be certain that we may never fully understand why God's love for you is an everlasting love. But it has been made complete in the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In him, know that your sins are forgiven. Receive now this good news with joy and readiness to share this same joy with all who are around you. Amen. And so Jesus comes to us in the physical presence, in with and under the bread and wine is his body and blood. And as humans, we long for this physical connection, and God comes to us in these elements, and through the word and through the physical bread and wine. And though it is a mysterious gift, it is a gift we believe and we receive through him. And so now we come to the Lord's table and receive these gifts. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. You may have a seat.
Just a reminder that the gluten-free wafers are separated out on the table, as are the non-alcoholic cups of grape juice, the other color that's in the communion tray, and ask for that specifically from the server if that is what you are needing and desiring.
Held the oceans in his hands. Who has numbered every grain of sand. Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Who has given counsel to the Lord? Who can question any of his words? Teach the one who knows all things. Who can fathom all his wondrous deeds? Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Behold, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. Who has felt the nails upon his hand, bearing all the guilt of sinful men? God eternal, humble to the grave, Jesus Savior, risen now to reign. Adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him. You will reign forever. Seated on his throne, come, let us adore him. Behold our King, nothing can compare. Come, let us adore him.
You please rise as you are able and receive the blessing. Now may this body and blood, bound in with and under the bread and wine, strengthen and preserve you, body and soul, into the one true faith and into life everlasting. Go in his precious peace. Amen. We pray, we give thanks to you, Almighty God, for you have refreshed us again through this gift of Jesus' body and blood. We ask that you would strengthen us through this gift in our faith toward you and in our love toward one another, that we might share in the good news of your rescue for all the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And then we pray as a family. We pray for our church here and our community at large and the ones in need in and around us. We have a prayer bulletin, or a prayer list that you can follow along with. We ask that you take this with you through the week, and you can pray for the names on this list, for healing, for comfort, and that you can pray for those that are not on this list as well. Heavenly Father, we continue to be reminded to not be afraid of what the future holds, to not worry about tomorrow. But you know how difficult we find it to heed these words. For we worry about so many things, our family, our friends, our circumstances. Some worries are big, some worries are small. And so we come before you this day with these big and these small worries, with the confidence that we know we can lay them all at your feet. We bring our big worries about health and happiness and security for ourselves and for our loved ones. We bring big worries about the world we live in and its future. We bring big worries about the way people in this world are treated or cared for. But we know, Lord, you have it all in your hands. And so we do lift up to you those that are struggling with health concerns, those are struggling with pain and addiction, those are dealing with emotional stress. And we lift them to you, Lord, knowing that that you are concerned with every aspect of our lives. The worries that keep us awake at night, the worries which only you know. Living God, you reach out to all those to whom the future brings fear and uncertainty. You assure them then that you are with them, even when that future seems dark and the circumstances feel like they are spiraling out of control. Remind them that you are able to transform even the bleakest situation and bring healing and wholeness. And Lord, we celebrate the blessings that we see. We celebrate the birth of Grant to Ted and Emily, who was born on August 2nd. We celebrate this, where your word is being spread throughout the country, not just here, but throughout the world, and the joy and peace of knowing you. We pray also, Lord, that you, for the country, more importantly, for the leadership of our country. We give a thanksgiving for those who protect our freedoms in this country, for all our military, extended friends and family who have been called into active duty, for Marcus and for Seth. And we pray that you know all, Lord, and that our prayers are to you in faith, and we know that your Spirit is at work in the world, making all things new. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We pray the prayer that he has taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power in the glory forever and ever. Amen. And just a reminder, we share the gifts that God has given us with not just the church, but with the community at large. We entrust our resources to God, knowing that it is for His work, for the ministry which He has called us here for today. And with that, we continue to praise Him through your song.
Our God will reign forever, and all the world will know His name. Everyone together, sing the song of the redeemed. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what He did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, You are the only way. My Savior lives. The King has come from heaven, and darkness trembles at His name. Victory forever is the song of the redeemed. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what He did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, You are the only way. My Savior lives. 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 I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what He did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, You are the only way. My Savior lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what He did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, You are the only way. My Savior lives.
You go into the week, know this, that the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you His peace. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
My Savior lives. 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 I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what He did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new day.